My name is Britt van Rooy. Next to me is sitting Frans van der Vossen. She's a professor in cardiovascular biomechanics. I'm a member of the VPH Institute student committee. The student committee organized webinars and events for VPH Institute members, but also VPH students. The VPH Institute is a non-profit organization, and it wants to realize a virtual physiological human. So, and hopefully it will be used also in the future, also in the clinic. So today, Frans will talk about model predictive medical decision support system for cardiovascular diseases. I think it's time to start.
Okay. Thank you very much, Britt, for the introduction. As told, I will present some ideas about how the virtual physiological human can be used as models to predict the outcome of medical intervention, and in that way can be a medical decision support system. And we will focus today on the cardiovascular diseases. So this is a short overview of my webinar today. I will start with an introduction, and then, as promised in my abstract, I will use three real clinical applications to illustrate what the ideas are of, behind my presentation. And in the end, of course, I will pose a few conclusions, concluding remarks, and some discussion points. Let's start with what I mean with model predictive clinical decision support. Before that, I will give a short motivation why we focus this to the cardiovascular diseases. And that's because if you think about cardiovascular disease, of course, we talk about mainly about coronary artery disease, heart failure, and arrhythmias, neurovascular diseases like problems in the cerebral circulation, and congenital heart diseases. And these diseases together are, of course, responsible for, first of all, high mortality. About one out of three people die due to cardiovascular diseases, and high costs. We spend quite some money on cardiovascular health care. This makes cardiovascular health care one of the focus areas of biomedical research, and also one of the focus areas in the VPH community. Model predictive decision support is a term that I took from actually from engineering or from automotive industry. And there it's well known that you can use model predictive control. And I will try to explain what is meant by that. If you buy a car nowadays, then you don't only buy an engine, but also a computer. And this engine is controlled by a computer, and this computer contains a lot of software that is used as a predictive model that tells the engine, that knows how the engine will change its behavior due to changes in input. So if you increase the oxygen or whatever, then this model can predict what would be the outcome of the engine doing that. So it knows the process. And by measuring all kind of data from the engine, it can also know the state of the motor, and in that way use the reference, so the behavior you would like to have the motor, together with the predictive model, to adapt the input and to get an output that is close to the reference. So that's a little bit how it works in automotive industry. And of course, this can be used also in a wrong way, as we all know, but normally this is used to let the car drive in an optimal way. So the model decides how the process must be altered as it knows its state and can predict its behavior. And we can translate this model predictive control to what we do in the hospital. Of course, there we don't have an engine, but we have a process that is taking place in a patient. You can also see this as a patient. And we do all kind of medical intervention in order to let the patient outcome be optimal. And of course, also here we do all kinds of measurements that could be imaging, that could be functional measurements like blood pressure or whatever. And if we would have a predictive model that could predict the outcome based on a certain intervention, then we can make indeed a model predictive control system out of this, or a model predictive clinical decision support system out of this. So in this case, the model can support decisions as it knows the patient's state and it can predict its behavior after intervention. So that's the idea about model predictive clinical decision support. And of course, to achieve this and to get this implemented in the hospital, we need quite some steps to make. And I will spend a few words on the steps to make, but also on why this is important. First of all, if we want to bring the mathematical model into a clinical application using this principle of predictive modeling in order to enhance diagnosis and predict outcome intervention, we have to be aware that we have, of course, people in universities working on mathematical models or at industry and the clinic. And that's quite a distance. And to bridge this, we must be aware that all the clinical applications take place in the clinic, that in the medical centers. And they use products and protocols, protocols that are demanding how they should take care of the patients, and products that are certified to use. And these products are, of course, products that come from medical industry. And the university in this way can intervene in this process by either working together with the clinical partners and defining new protocols, but also by working together with the medical industry and preparing, defining, or designing new prototypes that can be used to get new products. So this is the triangle in which this work we do should take place. And that's, I think, an important way to work. Next, what we should be aware of, if we use technology or models to improve healthcare, we must be aware of this, what I call a technologically healthcare cycle. We are all aware that the population is aging at this time. So there's an increased need of healthcare and healthcare capacity. For this, we need, of course, a budget. And each country has to fight in some way to get this budget together to have a healthcare system that is working quite well. But it also asks for improvement. So we need quality improvement of the healthcare in order to make sure that we can cope with this aging population. And of course, this also takes a budget from our taxpayers, let's say it in that way. And predictive modeling could be a way to indeed improve this quality. Of course, there are all kinds of different ways, but we talked today about predictive modeling, and that could improve this quality. Suppose that we succeed in some way to get this budget and to do this predictive modeling, this quality improvement will lead to advances in diagnosis and therapy, and in the end will lead again to aging of the population. So here we have a cycle which is not sustainable. Mm-hmm. So we must be sure that these budgets are in some way earned back from the technological improvements. And that's why we need another budget, which is at least as big as A and B together, that reduces the costs. So we must be clear that we not only develop technology to improve quality, but also reduce the costs. And that's a part of the of the way of thinking we should take into account. Okay, let's now see what this means for the model makers, for instance, and the people that will use the model. So, and I used to define four phases: a definition phase, a preclinical phase, a clinical phase, and a production phase. Of course, first we have to define the problem in some way. And in a preclinical phase, oh, that's not what I meant. Yeah, here we are. In the preclinical phase, first of all, we have to develop the model. So we develop mostly patient-specific generic computational models. In our case, in the cardiovascular system, on fluid-solid interaction problems. And once these models are developed, then of course there's a second phase in which we have to verify these models. But mostly we do this through advanced experimental methods in the laboratory. So that's the second step, and still long before you are ending in the clinic. A next phase would be to characterize the materials we are talking about. That could be the vessel wall, the heart muscle, the tissue of the valves, whatever kind of cardiovascular tissue. We need mechanobiological characterization. That means not only the nonlinear behavior, but also in many cases, the adaptive behavior. So how does the material behave in the long term? Because if we do an intervention in the clinic, of course, we are also interested in the long term outcome. So that's quite some work to be done even before you go into the clinic. The last preclinical step is the one in which you try to implement all these phases into the clinic. And mostly what you need there is measurement techniques that can be used in the clinic to get these material properties, which we need for the material characterization, out of the patients. And preferably, we want to do this non-invasively. So here you develop techniques, measurement techniques, but also ways to incorporate the software into a clinical workflows to make this model predictive decision support possible. Then in the clinical phase, of course, first of all, you need to analyze the workflow and see if what you have invented here safely in your laboratory can be used in a clinical setting. And it's very important to make sure that the clinical setting is such that this allowed from ethical point of view, but also possible from economic point of view or from point of view of the acceptation of the doctors, the medical doctors in the clinic. And the next step mostly is, and that's more an experience kind of step, that you have to adapt the model. So the model you use is often not good enough, and you need some optimization of the model to make it work also in patient-specific modeling. And then the next step, and that's an important step, is to assess the important input and design input parameters and design measurement protocols to get these parameters out of the patient. And for this, you need, in many cases, because we have many parameters, sensitivity analysis to perform to find out which parameters are important and which can be maybe taken as a population average. And then the last step is, of course, to prove that this model that has been developed to support decision indeed makes decisions better. And that's, of course, normally done by a clinical study in which you compare the treatment of patients with and without the model. And what you should also take into account here is how certain are you about this support. So there's a uncertainty quantification needed to tell the system that how certain these decisions can be taken. So that's the way of working, and I will use now three clinical applications to show this in more detail for typical applications. And the first one I want to look at is the problem of patients with kidney end-stage kidney disease. So they have a problem with the functioning of and regulation of blood pressure and the functioning and removal of waste products. And this makes this end-stage renal disease as a life-threatening situation, which ideally is solved by performing renal replacement therapy. But this is not always possible because of shortage in these transplants and maybe other problems that prevent from doing this replacement therapy. And all those patients that need for some way to survive using hemodialysis. So in that case, hemodialysis machine is used to take blood from the patient into the machine, clean it and give it back to the patient. And to work properly and to work not too long, so say for 3 times 3 hours a week, you need at least 300 to 500 milliliters, say 300 milliliters of blood to take from the patient. This is a difficult task because normal arteries don't supply so much blood. So in normal arteries, you cannot take 300 milliliters per minute, then you collapse the artery if you try to suck it out. So what can be done is to make a vascular access in such a way that you can take, say, 500 milliliters per minute and can do that week after week, 3 times a week. And in order to be able to do that, you need to make either to take it from the aorta or vena cava, but that's of course not a very good option, or create surgically a connection between an artery and a vein, as shown here. So here we have the arteries and the veins in the arm, and you can of course make a connection by taking ligate one of the veins, connected to the artery, then wait for a while. Here you see this kind of connections. If you wait for a while, then you get maturation of the artery and the vein because of the high flow. So they will increase in diameter and flow will increase. And then you have a good situation after this maturation that can take 6 to 10 weeks to take out enough blood for dialysis. So that's the surgical option to take. It looks not too complicated, but there are quite some complications involved. Here you see how this dialysis machine can take the blood out of the fistula. There are a few choices where you can make such kind of fistula that could be either in the lower arm or in the upper arm. Lower arm is preferable, but in 20 to 50% of the cases, you have too low post-operative flow and no maturation. So then you cannot use this AVF for dialysis. And then you have to move to the upper arm to make an anastomosis over here, with the danger that you either create ischemia in the hand, so there's not enough blood supply anymore for the hand, or you can induce cardiac failure due to a too high blood flow through this fistula. It can go up to 1 to 2 liters, and the heart, of course, has to cope with that. So the decision here to make is which kind of anastomosis should I make in which kind of patients? And the aim of the model that we can try to develop here is a model that is able to predict the post-operative flow enhancement. So it can predict the flow if you make a lower arm or an upper arm anastomosis. And this prediction, this could be indicative for success rate of the operation. First of all, of course, you have to design and develop the model. So here, in this case, since we are looking at a quite complicated system with many, many arteries and veins and connections between the two, we opt for a one-dimensional wave propagation model that was developed in our case, but many groups developed this kind of models some time ago, and where we solve the Navier-Stokes equations, so the equations for fluid flow in distensible arteries, integrated over cross sections of the diameter. I will not go into the details of the method, but this is a relatively simple, ends up in a relatively simple model that can be used to compute the flow in the entire arterial system, and that can be used also then to see how a connection between an artery and a vein will change the blood flow. So as I said, one of the important things to do in this kind of models is to get the material properties of the veins. And for the veins, we know that we have a strong nonlinear behavior of the pressure radius relation, as you can see here. In the physiological range, it looks more or less linear, so you could opt for linear models. But if you want to take into account this nonlinear behavior, and sometimes, especially if you overstretch veins like we do in the anastomosis, we need a little bit more detail. And for that, we have to find out how this behavior is by doing measurements. And secondly, we have to define nonlinear models to do that. And in our case, we solved this nonlinearity by introducing a fiber reinforced model, like the model of Holzapfel. We did quite some measurements on different kind of arteries and find out that the parameters in the model, so that's the shear modulus, but also the parameters of the nonlinear part, K1, K2, these parameters of the model seem to be relatively independent of the kind of artery. So would be nice if we could fix these parameters in a given population. So depending on the kind of artery, but also depending on the patient. And what we found out is that if you fit this model with a phenomenological model that was introduced some time ago by Langewouters, we could fit the parameters of the physiological models with the parameters of our fiber reinforced model. And that if you do this, and of course you have to do some calculations for that, we end up in a model in which all the parameters in this phenomenological model, A, B, P max, and PW, could be fitted with the parameters we measured in our arteries we had in our laboratory. And the only change would be the between arteries would be the ratio between the wall thickness and the radius of the tube. So that would be nice, because that would mean that we just need the radius and the wall thickness of the tube to define the material properties of the arteries at different sites in the cardiovascular system. Once you have done this and you can fit it with and then you can fit also the compliance of the phenomenological model and compare it with the model that we fitted, and that looks very nice, then you can plug that into your 1D wave propagation model, and that's what you finally did. Okay, so that's the material characterization. The next step, of course, is here you see then the outcome of such a model. So you can make a model of the whole arterial tree, you can make as many details if you want, if you have the properties, and then you can compute pressure and flow at several sites in the arterial system, so also in the arm, and you could also find out what happens if you make connections. Of course, you have to verify this model. This has been done in a simple setup in which we have a tube in which we try to use this model and find out if the wave that travels through this tube by opening a valve and to look at the wave propagation reflection at the two sides of the tube and find out if the model could predict what we measure in our laboratory. And a first verification test we did gave this result. And this was quite disappointing. So the predicted value was the dotted line. So very nice. And these are all reflections of the wave. Very nice pattern without much damping. But the measurement turned out to be quite different. So there was a damped system here. So in some way, we missed something in the model. And of course, we were lucky that we found out what the problem was, that the materials we used were not elastic, but viscoelastic. So we extended the model with a viscoelastic material. And in that case, you can perfectly match the experiments with the model. So this gave us the confidence that the 1D wave propagation model at least could be verified experimentally in vitro situations. Of course, that does not guarantee that it can be used in the clinic yet. So the next step is to try to use this model in the clinical workflow to find out how you can use it. And in our case, of course, we have data of the patient that could be an MRI or a CT image or something that you just derive from measurements with ultrasound or just looking at the length of the arm, of course. And you could use this model and make a 1D wave propagation model with resistances at the end to fit the parameters in such a way that measurements you can do, you can use, for instance, a Doppler measurement to measure the pressure, the flow at certain locations and compare. And then you can fit the model preoperatively to the patient. And then, of course, you can introduce two scenarios, an upper arm or a lower arm connection with the veins, and use the model to compute what would be the flow through the veins. And then this could be compared to a final outcome. But these results could also be used to make a decision about what is the best option for this patient, the upper arm or the lower arm connection. What we also learned from applying this, that the model and the measurements we could do in the patients were quite different. And the reason for that, and that's what I mean with model optimization, once you are in the clinic, you learn that the model maybe is too simple in some aspects. And in this case, we saw that and of course we could have seen this beforehand, that the pressure drop over the anastomosis, so this is the distal artery, this is the proximal artery, and this is the vein, so the flow goes like this. Then you get quite some high pressure drop from here to there. And this pressure drop was not taken into account in the 1D model. But of course, by doing some dimensionless analysis, you can find out that due to losses, energy losses, but also viscous losses, you will have an extra pressure drop that is proportional to the square of the flow. And if you introduce this extra pressure drop using some parameters and using the angle, for instance, and the difference between diameters or cross-sectional areas of the veins, then you can add this to your 1D model, which is quite easy to do. You get much better comparison between measurements in the clinic and performance of the model. So here you see, how do you get this? Of course, then you use, and I will give you another example where we do this, a complex model like a computational fluid dynamics computation in 3D to get these parameters out of. Of course, you can you can define the parameters, but to get them out of the patient with a patient-specific situation, you can use a 3D model to get this pressure difference and then try to fit it in such a way that you can use it in the 1D model. And that has been done in this application. Okay, then the next step is a personalization of the model, because you can understand that this 1D model, although it seems to be a simple model, still has a lot of parameters. All the arteries have a length, a diameter, an elastic property, tapering maybe, so, and all these properties are parameters in our model. And what we need to do is to find out which of these parameters are important and which of these parameters maybe are less important and could be taken as a patient generic value. And for that we introduce of course a global sensitivity analysis, and in our case we make use of two effects, the main effect and the total effect. The main effect is the expected reduction in the variance of your outcome, and you have to define the outcome for that, if the exact value of one of the parameters is known. And if this is large, of course, it makes use to reduce the variance of this one parameter. And then you also reduce the variance in your output. So that's especially useful for prioritization of some parameters and say, okay, these are the important parameters. The total effect is a different measure. It is the expected variance that is left if all factors except for one of the parameters, XY, are exactly known. And this is a parameter that can be used in the case that this total effect is low. It is quite safe to fix this parameter to a certain value and don't care too much about exact measurements. Okay, by applying these two indices in our model, and we had a model with at that moment 47 generic values, we could prioritize it in such a way that there are only five of these parameters that are important. And here they are mentioned for certain output, and the output in that case was the flow in the brachial artery. So that helped us to find out which parameters should be measured more carefully using either MRA or ultrasound, and which parameters could be fixed. And that can, of course, simplify your model, but also increase the uncertainty decrease the uncertainty, actually, of your final outcome. So the sensitivity analysis gives insight in how to optimize the model personalization. So that's the step where you really make your model patient specific. Okay, let's see how this works and how this can be used in this AVS decision support system. Of course, we have this predictive model that can predict the outcome if you do some intervention. So make this connection, and you base this on all kind of measurements you have done. One of the things that is not in the 1D model is the vascular maturation, so the adaptation. So in that case, we learned that the preoperative situation, this, the flow in the brachial artery immediately after the intervention, is still quite different from what happens after 6 weeks. And the reason for that is that the arterial walls will adapt their radius. So this is the radius A, will change in time, and that depends on the wall shear, stress or wall shear rate, whatever you want. And there's some rate constant K involved in there, which we don't know. And of course, we could make go one direction in studying exactly what is going on in the arterial wall to find out what this parameter could be. Another possibility is use a phenomenological model, so that you use all kind of data from the patient, so the patient record data, but also what you know from population average data, and use some artificial intelligence to find out how this K would be for different kind of patients. And for instance, there we learned that for diabetic patients, this K is completely different than for patients without diabetes. So, but you could also find, as long as you can use machine learning kind of techniques, get also some information about this K and put it into the model. And if you do this, you can come up with results that that look a little bit like this. So this is one of the results of this end-stage renal disease project, which was a European project within the VPH, in which we compared the measured brachial blood flow after 6 weeks in milliliters per minute, and compared that with the simulated brachial blood flow, simulations done before the intervention. And there you see that there's a very nice correlation between the two. You see the different patients separately. And that means that this prediction of flow went quite well, and that indeed this model could be used then in clinic to support a decision about where to make this anastomosis. Of course, you also have to deal with uncertainty. And of course, the tools we have available now allow us to do many, many computations with variation in the parameters that we think to be important. And that means that this Brachial flow can compute it in between some range. So we have not only the predicted value of the Brachial flow, but also the range in which we hope and think this value will be, depending on the variation of the input parameters. So that completes more or less the end-stage renal disease example I want to show. I have two other smaller examples to show after this. So the 1D model was used and was developed and was verified experimentally. So that was a first step. And it was applied in a clinical study to show that that it can very well predict the optimal clinical choice for vascular access. We have not yet shown that it is also cost saving, but you can imagine if you can save reoperation of patients, that this could be essential, but it's not clear yet. What is important and what is work in progress at this moment is especially that new techniques, more efficient techniques for sensitivity and uncertainty analysis are developed now to make the model also more faster in use in the clinic, because you want fast answers. Okay, let me conclude this part and go to a next application, and that's abdominal aortic aneurysms. These are widenings of the aorta, as you can see here. If this widening in the aorta is larger than 3 centimeters, we talk about an aneurysm. These aneurysms are mostly asymptomatic, so patients don't know that they have an aneurysm, but they are that far dangerous that they can rupture. And once an aneurysm ruptures, the mortality is bigger than 80%, so that's not a good thing. And that makes aneurysms about the 13th cause of death in Western world. But of course, many patients know that they have an aneurysm, just by accident, or by doing some screening kind of research. And then, of course, the decision the surgeon has to make is, do I intervene? Because there are quite some interventions possible. You can replace this by a stent graft, or you can use an endovascular stent graft. But this operation is still a mortality of about 4%, depending a little bit on the condition of the patient. So that's quite risky too. So we have two risks to weigh. One is the risk of rupture, and one is the risk of intervention. And we don't want to intervene if the risk of rupture is lower than the risk of intervention. Question, of course, is what is the risk of rupture? And that would be the size, maybe, and that's what is nowadays used. So they measure the diameter of the aneurysm, the maximum diameter, and if it is bigger than 5 or 5.5, then the risk of rupture is believed to be larger than the risk of intervention. Or when the growth is larger than 1 centimeter per year, then the risk of rupture also increases. At least that is what we know from the clinic. Problem is that smaller aneurysms than 5.5 do rupture, and larger aneurysms that are not operating on do survive and are stable. So this criteria is not good enough. And the question now is can we develop a model that can predict the growth of the aneurysm, or maybe predict rupture, but I believe more in growth than in rupture prediction. And for that, of course, again, you have to develop your models. In this case, it's a three-dimensional finite element model that computes the solid stress, the stress in the solid tissue of the artery or of the aneurysm, based on MRI or CT images. So the geometry is obtained from MRI and CT, and using the aortic pressure wave, you can compute the stresses, as you can see here, visualized by the color, Red means high stress, and these stresses could be indicative for risk of rupture or for growth. This model is not very simple because we have to take into account that if this is the size of the artery as we measure it with CT, we must be aware that already there's a diastolic or mean pressure inside this artery. So that this, this is not a stress-free situation. So to compute the stress in systolic phase, if you go from diastolic to systolic, we have to take into account the existing stress already already in the diastolic phase. So we have to compute back the situation which is stress-free, and even the closed artery without pressure inside is not stress-free. If you open it, then you get an opening angle. So you have to take into account this whole cycle to make this model useful. And once you have done this, you can also see that there's quite some difference in taking a model in which we don't take into account this residual or pre-stress, initial stress, and a model in which you do take into account this stress. If you don't take into account this initial stress, you overestimate the deformation and you underestimate actually the stress inside the artery. So that was done, and then verified again. As I told you, you need always to verify what you're doing. So in this case, we had 10 patients in which we were allowed to measure the pressure inside the aneurysm. These patients were eligible for intervention, so we could do that short before the intervention, and use MRI to dynamically look at the arterial wall. And then, of course, you can make a pressure radius relationship and get some influence about the material properties of the wall, and use that in your model. And then you can also compare, and that's what is done in here, the deformation you measure with the MRI and compare that with the deformation you compute with the Fine-Edelman method. And here you see the, for instance, the error made between the two, and it's quite close except for the locations where you constrained the wall and fix its displacement, but here it's quite close, so that gives you the feeling about the accuracy of the model. Then if you use this model in many patients, you can of course find out that and these are all different patients, that you can compute the maximum stress, or what we often do is compute the 99 or 95% percentile stress, because maximum stress is often dependent on some artifacts in your mesh. And then of course each of these patients have a certain maximum stress, and you can compare that with the diameter. And if you do that, and that's what we did of course, then you see that there's a good correlation between the peak stress and the diameter, which was in first instance a little bit disappointing, because we did a lot of work to compute these stresses, and then in the statistically it gave the same information as the diameter. So in that case, the diameter would be a good indication for risk of rupture or growth. But of course, due to the spread in the data, we can define three groups. This is a group, the open dots, of patients that have a relatively low maximum stress compared to the trend. And the black dots are patients with a relatively high stress in the wall compared to the trend. So here you compare the groups with the trend group, I would say. And there you can learn that at least the patients with the low stress, if you follow them up, and that's what we did, we looked at several months after, that the growth in these patients is lower than growth in these patients. That means that with one single measurement, and computing the stress, you can have an indication about growth of the aneurysm. And that means that you can stratify the patients and use this stratification to say to these patients here to come back early to monitor what is going on. And maybe these patients could be left alone for some while and monitor them maybe after 1 year. Whereas you do these patients after 1 month. So that's very useful and could be very useful also in the clinic, not about decision about intervention, but decision about managing of the patients. So also here we see that the model was used, was verified and applied in the clinic. At this moment, a lot of work is done, not only by our group, but also by others, to see if the CT and MRI that is used to compute the geometries of these patients could be replaced by ultrasound. Because that would make it much easier to use in a follow-up study. Ultrasound is cheaper. Can be used to for dynamic measurements, and that was is now in done. Here you see a geometry and the stress computation from ultrasound imaging, so not from CT. And in a group of patients, the Emil van Disseldorp compared the ultrasound-based peak stress with peak stress that was computed from the CT images, the same patient. And then you see that only for the 99% percentile, so if you look at the detail of even artifacts, you see some deviation, but for the 95 and even for the lower, you get a very nice correlation between the two. So that proves us that this ultrasound-based stress analysis could be very useful. There was also a study done on the problem that with ultrasound, maybe you cannot get the full aneurysm as an image, but if you compare images that were made with only part of the geometry, you see a very good comparison. So that can be that is not a very tough issue. And what is good about this is that now we use ultrasound. Of course, these are patient groups here with in a certain age and with maybe it's better to look here. These are patients groups with an aneurysm about 3 centimeters. But we can compare them now with volunteers because the ultrasound can be used, not CT cannot be used, but ultrasound can be used also to measure in volunteers. So we can compare now volunteers with patients. So that's one advantage. And secondly, we can follow up much after because we don't have any radiation by CT in ultrasound. So that's about aneurysms. And now I will use a last application about coronary artery disease. Again, to go through this scheme, but now maybe focus a little bit more on future applications. So in the case of coronary artery disease, we have to deal with stenosis, so blockage of the coronary arteries. These are the arteries that supply the heart. And these coronary arteries can be visualized using X-ray. And of course, here it's clear that this artery is blocked in some way, and maybe also clear what to do. But in this case here, maybe you should put a stent, maybe not. So the question there is, what do we have to do? Do nothing, give medical indication, medication, place a stent, or maybe go for bypass surgery. And what we want to do, of course, with our model is to predict the outcome of these interventions, these different kind of interventions that are possible. So in our case, for instance, predict what would be the effect in opening this artery here, would then indeed the blood flow increase again and the patient be out of problems. So for that, in clinical practice, an index is introduced called the FFR, which is actually the pressure ratio between the distal and proximal pressure over the stenosis. And this is, if you want a measure of, yeah, this can be used as a measure for what is called the a measure for the flow through this artery if there's a stenosis in the artery, divided by the flow if the stenosis would be if you would do an intervention. And if you would have known, if you know this ratio, then of course you can predict what the intervention would what would be the outcome of the intervention. And by using a simple device, which is a sensor on top, inside a guide wire that is used in the clinic anyways to guide the catheter for the contrast agents for X-ray, then you could use this not to measure the flows, which we actually need, but to measure the pressures, the pressure proximal and distal. And as, if we just use the law of Ohm, which is tells us that the flow is the pressure difference divided by resistance, and we make sure that the resistance, which is the resistance in the peripheral arteries, is constant. That means that we open all the arteries as much as possible, so that's a hyperemic situation, so you give some medication to open the arteries, then the resistance here in the distal part will not change, and then of course the pressure difference, this pressure minus the venous pressure divided by this resistance, is a measure for the flow, and of course the loss you have due to the stenosis is the pressure over here divided by there. So that means that if the stenosis would not be there, then this pressure would be equal to this pressure. And so if you measure the proximal pressure divided by the resistance, you get the flow if the stenosis would not be there. So this pressure measurement is a very good indication for the flow difference with and without the stenosis in the hyperemic situation. So this is used in the clinic as a measure, but based on a very, very simple, I have to hurry a little bit, very simple law, the law of Ohm, and of course this cannot be true, at least that's what people thought. But if you then, and that's why I mentioned it, use a more complex model, in which you take into account all the non-linearities of the system, and use that model and compare the results with the simple model, then you learn, and I will just show the result here, that the complex model and the simple model come up with the same kind of results. So the FFR based on the simple law of Ohm is more or less identical to the FFR based on the complex model. That tells us that the complex model looks complex, but in the end, for the output we want to use it, it's very simple. And that makes it useful to use in the clinic, and that actually has been done for the FFR. And it is shown, and here you see that you, if you can do a real clinical study, here 500 patients were treated in the classical way, just looking at the X-ray image, and 500 patients were treated by measuring the FFR, and only treat if the FFR is low enough, so below a certain value. And then you see that the outcome of these patients, which is model predict, with model predictive decision support, is 30% better for myocardial infarction, for death, and for repeat vascularization, 30% lower than for the classical way of treatment. So you indeed improved in this way, proved in this way that this model predictive decision support is useful. This is summarized in this slide. I want to just show you a final slide, which is, of course, the slide in which you can replace these measurements of the pressure by computation of the pressure. So what you can do is use what is called FFRCT. So use the CT value, the CT data of the patient, and measure use this geometry to compute the pressure inside this geometry and compute from there the FFR. And this is commercially available now and is used already in many hospitals. So you then don't have to do the intervention with the wire to get a good measure for the significance of the stenosis. However, you need, of course, boundary conditions for this, and this is still an open question. And here again, I will show you that using other kind of data, so patient record data, population average data, and some artificial intelligence like machine learning or deep learning to assimilate the extra information you don't have, you cannot measure directly, but you can measure maybe due to this extra data from the patient, you can get reasonable values for these boundary conditions patient specifically. Finally, once you have these models available, we could make a next step, and it's also a step that could be interesting for our community, is to use meta kind of models. If you have done 1,000 of these patients, the 1,001 patient probably is somewhere in between the parameter range of these 1,000. So you could use this information to get a very fast result for the next patient, and also there machine learning could be something to be used. So this concludes my webinar today. So I showed you that new developments in physiological modeling and computational models and computer power create new opportunities for models, that these models needs to go through a chain of activities in order to be used in the clinic, and that also in the clinic, especially sensitivity analysis and sensitivity analysis and also uncertainty quantification is important for the final application in the clinic. And that combination of physiological modeling with data modeling, so could be used to get even more information out of the patient, use some artificial intelligence to improve our models, and finally that reduced order models could even also improve the efficiency of using these models. So that's a little bit the line. I would like to end with thanking all the people who did work. Actually, I'm just talking about it, but all people worked in it, many postdocs, PhD students, and master and bachelor science students, and this is the team in my group that worked on this work together, of course, with hospitals and clinics. So with this, I would like to end my webinar, and we'd be happy to answer questions that came up in the audience.
Okay, thank you very much, Frans. So some questions are coming in, so we can go to some questions. So we have a question from Yas. He's asking, what software is used to create patient-specific in silico model, assuming such models are created from person-specific clinical image data? Mm-hmm. And if this software gives robustic next models, or it requires substantial cleaning pre-processing before the model is really useful?
Okay, yeah, that's a very good question, but I don't think there's a one simple general answer to the question. It depends a little bit on the application, what kind of software is used. I showed already that in some occasions you can use quite simple models that could be lump parameter models or 1D wave propagation models. In other situations, like for the aneurysm, for instance, we need a more complex three-dimensional model, sometimes even three-dimensional fluid structure interaction models. There are several, of course, commercial packages that can be used, but not always are allowed to be used. If you really want to bring them into the clinic, then you need certification. And that's why, in many cases, the imaging industry, like Siemens, Philips, whatever kind of, are trying to integrate this kind of software in the imaging software. But of course, this will be small steps that can be made due to the certification of using this kind of extra information for decision support. So no general answer. And part of the question was also if you need for optimization of the model. Once you have developed the model at your computer at home or at a university and want to use it in the clinic, you will learn that all kind of artifacts circumvent you for using the model straight away. So you have often to do some manual work or improve the model in such a way that it is automated. So there's a lot of work to do in that field.
So we have another question from Andy Manuela. I have a question on the verification of a model. Mm-hmm. After the model is tuned with patient data, it's often checked with ex vivo tissue experiments. My question is the ex vivo tissue stiffer than in vivo tissue? If so, isn't it difficult to verify and also validate results of a model tuned with in vivo data by using ex vivo experiments?
Yeah, that's a good question. Of course, you try to do your best. So what you can do, if you are not able yet maybe to measure material properties directly in the patient, you have to find something that is the best you can do. That could be either tissue from slaughterhouses, so from animals, or tissue from the from cadavers or from patients, if it can become available. And then you must be aware that you translate that, first of all, from a living situation to a not living, ex vivo, maybe a little bit living situation. So that will change the properties, certainly. Also, if you use tissue from other species, of course, you are not sure that the properties are the same. But you hope not to get the real material parameters, but its material behavior in some way out of these experiments. Once you have the material behavior and translated it to a constitutive model, then you could hope that if you get measurements out of the patient, and that's where you use, for instance, ultrasound techniques to look at deformation depending on pressure, then you could use the same kind of constitutive relation, but come up with other parameters, of course, which are typically for this patient. But of course, this is not an obvious step, but it's the best you can do.
So we have one more question from Pavel. Thanks for the very interesting talk. Can you please give the details on the publication compared to FFR results obtained with the resistance compliance and the simple resistance one?
Yeah, so if you send me an email, I think my email will be available somewhere, mm-hmm. then I will find out which is the best to send and to be able to.
Yeah. And this presentation will also be online.
Yeah, but maybe not the details are available. So yeah. I can certainly do that.
Okay. So Marta has also a question. Hi, very nice presentations. Two questions. First question, which segmentation software did you use? And second mm-hmm. question, I didn't get how you calculated the diameter of the aorta to be used in the model. The diastolic or systolic one? Thank you very much.
Yeah, okay, so if we talk about the work on the aneurysms, the previous research we did together with Philips Research, and together with Philips we developed a software tool that was integrated in their imaging software, which was called Hemodyne, which is not commercially available. And there they used quite sophisticated segmentation techniques, which I don't know exactly which they are, but developed by Philips. Nowadays you can find segmentation techniques, but sometimes you have to do some work on your own to optimize them. Regarding the ultrasound data, this is software that is developed in-house. So it's available in my group, especially in the group of Richard Lopata. Probably not commercially available at this moment, but also probably not 100% unique, but also based on existing techniques. But it's always, yeah, it's always a difficulty to get a good segmentation software that fits with your workflow. But it's not one single for all. That was one part of the question.
And the second was how you calculate the diameter of the organ to be used, so in diastole.
And that's how they do it in the clinic. In some way, they try to find the maximum diameter. That's one which is along the axis we use, and that's a clinical practice. So how they exactly do it, I don't know, but that's at least the clinical way of measuring the diameter that is used for their decision support. But of course, if you have a real image, you can do better. You can try to find first the center line and then make planes perpendicular to the center line and then find for each plane the maximum diameter. That would be my choice. But.
After one more question. So it's from Rick. I'm a scientist at US FDA. Mm-hmm. We are active in trying to properly evaluate such modeling approaches.
Yeah.
One of the most difficult is proper evaluation of AI and so artificial intelligence and machine learning. Can you share some thoughts on how to validate that aspect of the approach?
Yeah, that's a good question, because this artificial intelligence way of looking at problems will not give you the mechanism of the model. So it's based just on data. One of the challenges, I think, is that we can use these the results of artificial intelligence, like deep learning or machine learning, to find ourselves the mechanisms again. And of course, from clinical point of view, you could just use them and build clinical comparison studies clinical studies to show, just as you do with trying a new drug, to show that if you use a certain artificial intelligence program compared with another, that patients are better off. But of course, from scientific point of view, this is not the best way to work, but probably a way that we need to go in some cases. So hopefully this answers a little bit, but it's a very difficult and good question. I don't think my answer is very, very good, but it's in the direction, I hope.
Okay, so I think that were the questions. So I would like to thank Frans again for giving this webinar. And,
you're welcome.
Thank you all for attending this webinar, and hope you will join the next webinar that's upcoming. You can find all events on the VPH Institute webpage. Bye.
Okay. Bye.